So, very good morning to all of you. Guys, I hope you all are doing great this week. So, guys, we could not have a live session tomorrow morning because of, today morning because of some technical issue. So, that is why we are putting up this recorded session. So, I hope this session benefits you and I hope you all are going to watch it, right? So, let's not waste any time and move straight away to our questions. Okay. So, are you ready for question number one? So, before moving to question number one, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel anujindal.in. That can help you to have access to a lot of good content that can help you to prepare for your exams, right? And don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to stay in touch with us and get updated regarding every notification that comes up. Okay, so finally moving on to question number one, and here is your question number one for today, which says, which of the following is or are not a non-tariff barrier? So guys, do read this question properly. Here are five type of barriers, trade barriers given to you. You have to tell which of the following is not a non-tariff, is not a non-tariff barrier, right? So let's see who answers this question correctly. And here are five options given to you: license, quota, safeguard duty, embargo, and sanctions, right? And you have to select the correct option out of these five. Let's see who answers correctly. Moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the solution is B, that is only three is not a non-tariff barrier. So guys, do understand this properly. Safeguard duty, not a non-tariff barrier. So it's not a non-tariff barrier, which means it is a tariff barrier, right? So all of these five options given to you, all of these are trade barriers. So what is meant by a trade barrier? A trade barrier is something that creates hindrance or any sort of problem in the free flow of trade. So aisi koi bhi cheez jo trade mein ya fir business mein kisi bhi cheez ki khareed bech mein rukawat paida kare, use bolte hain trade barrier. Aap naam se hi samajh sakte ho, jo trade ko rok raha hai ya trade ke raste mein barrier ban raha hai kisi tarike se, right? So yahan pe aapko do types puche gaye the, tariff aur non tariff. आपसे पूछा गया था कि आपको बताना है विच वन ऑफ द फॉलोइंग इज नॉट अ नॉन टैरिफ. जो नॉन टैरिफ नहीं है उसका मतलब जो टैरिफ है, राइट? सो सेफगार्ड ड्यूटी इज अ टैरिफ बैरियर. मूविंग अहेड, यहां पे आप देख सकते हैं फर्स्ट ऑप्शन. द फर्स्ट ऑप्शन सेज टैरिफ बैरियर. सो व्हाट इज अ टैरिफ बैरियर? इट इज अ टैक्स इम्पोज्ड ऑन इम्पोर्ट्स टू प्रोटेक्ट लोकल इंडस्ट्रीज और कंपनीज. सो यू मस्ट हैव सीन इन करंट सिनेरियो वेयर इंडिया इज ट्राइंग टू ब्लॉक एज मच एज इम्पोर्ट्स फ्रॉम चाइना, बिकॉज वी आर ट्राइंग टू कट आर डिपेंडेंस ऑन चाइनीज इम्पोर्ट्स एज इंडियन इकोनॉमी इज ह्यूजली डिपेंडेंट ऑन चाइना. चाइना से हमारे देश में बहुत माल आता है जिसको सरकार कम करने की कोशिश कर रही है, राइट? सो द पॉइंट इज, whenever government wants to cut these sorts of imports, they impose some taxes on such products. Obviously, if there is a tax imposed, that is going to increase the price of the product. Let's see, if there is a toy and that toy is being imported from China to India. Now, government says we are importing a tariff on it, or we are putting a tax on it. That is obviously going to raise the price of this toy. That is why it will become expensive to Indian consumers. That can help in curbing or reducing its demand, right? So do you see how trade barriers act? So this is a tariff barrier because here government is using a tax, or it is imposing a tax to increase the price of goods. But there are some other methods also by which a government can block the imports coming from another country. Other methods which do not make use of a tax or tariff, they are known as non-tariff barrier, using trade barriers in a form other than a tariff. So these are quotas, embargoes, sanctions, licenses, and VR. I think we all are familiar with these terms. Very simple term, quotas. When you decide, when the government decide that only this much quantity can be imported from the other country, not more than that. So you have put a limit to the quantity that can be imported, right? So that is quota. Embargo is simply putting a ban that this product cannot be imported into our country, right? Or this certain product cannot be imported from these countries from into our country. Right, so here just say like India can, if India wants to put an embargo, it can put on a certain country or on a certain product, ban a specific good or trade with a specific country, right? Sanctions against different countries that, okay, you are not going to export this product to us. Licenses, when government say that you need, that the importers in the country, they need a license to import a certain product. Right, so let's say if government says that smartphone makers in India, they need a license, smartphone traders in India, they need a license to import smartphones from China, then only they would be able to sell it here. So agar government bole ki India's mein jo bhi importer hai, jo bahar se maal mangwa ke yahan bech rahe hain दूसरी कंट्री से, चाइना से अगर उन्हें माल मंगवाना है तो लाइसेंस लेना पड़ेगा सर्टेन प्रोडक्ट के लिए. सो ऑब्वियसली इट इज गोइंग टू पुट सम रिस्ट्रिक्शन टू ट्रेड बिकॉज ऑल द इम्पोर्टर्स हु डू नॉट हैव लाइसेंस, दे कैन नॉट एक्ट और दे कैन नॉट सेल, राइट? आफ्टर दैट वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट VER इन दी इन फर्दर सेक्शन ऑफ दिस सेशन, राइट? सो आई होप नाउ यू आर क्लियर विद दिस. सो सेफ गार्ड ड्यूटी, इट्स अ टैरिफ बैरियर. रेस्ट आर non-tariff barrier. So whatever tax is imposed, that is going to come under the tariff barriers category, right? Now recently the revenue department, it has said that there is a safeguard duty, and this safeguard duty is going to continue on solar cells and panels for another year. So as you know, Indian government is on a spree to cut dependence on China. That is why they are imposing safeguard duty on import of solar cells and panels from China for another year, right? So a safeguard duty is going to be implemented on such solar cells and panels, right? So duty is to be paid at the rate of 14.9 for the first 6 months and 14.5 for the remaining 6 months. Also applies to imports from Thailand and Vietnam, but excludes imports from any other developing nation. So if any other developing nation exports to us, that is fine. But Thailand and Vietnam, if they import to us, a safeguard duty has to be made applicable. So the main aim behind this move is to prevent dumping of products by China, which is hurting our local manufacturers, right? So I think we all know the meaning of dumping, and we have also discussed it in one of our previous sessions. So dumping simply means throwing or selling your products at cheap rates in another country, which hurts their local manufacturers, right? So are you ready to move to question number 2? So here is question number 2 for today, which says, in respect to trade barrier VER, select the correct statement. So here are 5 statements given to you. I told you that we are going to study VER in the further section. Now you have to select the correct statement about VER from these 5 statements, right? So moving ahead to the solution of this question, and the solution for this question is A. So all those of you who answered as A, you guys are absolutely right. So VER, we just studied here. So could any one of you tell me the full form of VER? So do mention it in the comments if you know it. So if you don't know it, that is perfectly fine, because we are going to study it. VER means voluntary export restraint. So voluntary, the word voluntary in itself tells you that a country is putting a restraint to export by their own will, by their no other country has issued an official statement to stop their exports, but they themselves are putting a restraint or a stoppage to their own exports. So let's say if India says that, okay, we are not going to export this certain product to any other nation or to China or to Pakistan, then we are implementing a VER. सो अगर एक कंट्री खुद कहती है, अगर एक कंट्री खुद ही अपने एक्सपोर्ट्स पे एक तरीके की लिमिट लगा देती है या रुकावट लगा देती है, रिस्ट्रेंट लगा देती है, देन इट इज़ नोन एज वॉलेंट्री एक्सपोर्ट रिस्ट्रेंट. द वर्ड इन इटसेल्फ सेज वॉलेंट्री. So that is why the correct option is self-imposed, a limit that is self-imposed by the exporting country, right? So in earlier sections when we learned about licenses or quotas, one country is putting them against other country, but VER is self-imposed on itself. So you now you must be thinking that why would a country put restraint on its exports? Because exporting is good for the country, it generates foreign reserves, it generates foreign currency in the country, right? So why is a country going to implement VER? So the main reason that why a country implements VER is typically it is done when another country makes a request for doing so, right? So the most popular case of VER is Japan putting a restraint on its car export to US, right? So when Japan's economy was booming in around 1970s and 80s, it was manufacturing a lot of products at cheap rates and sending it across the world. So now US's car market was getting hugely affected by this, because Japan was sending cheaper and good quality cars to US. That is why American consumers, they were preferring Japanese cars. I think now also it's very common to find Toyota cars in US, right? So they are very much prevalent. So Japan was importing cheaper cars, sorry, Japan was exporting cheaper cars to US. Now US officials, they came in tension that now what do we do? Our car industry is, our automobile industry is getting under stress because of Japanese imports into our country, right? So now what did US do? US told Japan that please do not export such products into our country and let our industry boom. So Japan did the same on a request by US. It imposed a VER on itself and reduced its exports to US, right? So whether this benefited US car industry or not, that is in itself a different question, right? But Japan put up a VER. Now usually these VERs, they have been used by large developed economies. And now do you think that Japan would be really happy to impose a VER? Japan can say, okay, I'm producing a good quality cheap product, your consumer should have a benefit, why shouldn't I send my cheaper and good quality products to your country? Now an exporting country does act on a VER because it does not want to strain the relationships with other country, and also it does not want other country to act. So US might put a tariff on it or some quotas on it or licensing requirements on its importers, right? So that might harm Japan in a major way. That is why it says, okay, I'll take the responsibility, I will export in limit, right? So that is the reason that do not let the other country act, the exporting country in itself acts, right? To impose own restrictions then risk sustaining worse terms from tariffs or quotas, right? Now I hope you are clear with this. Producers in importing country experience an increase in well-being, though as there is decrease in competition, increased price, profits and employment. Now this, do you think this VER is going to help the importing country, that is US in this case? Because okay, their local industry might benefit, but there can be serious harm to it also, because first of all, there is going to be a decrease in competition. So since experience says whenever local industry is protected from foreign competition, it cannot grow to its full limit or full potential because they need competition. They need to see what is going on in world, what standards of quality are being followed. That is why it's very important to open up, to let your industries, to let your manufacturers see the global levels of quality. Then only they can match up with it. So in India, you can also see that till the time our industries were protected from competition, from foreign competition, they didn't see much growth, right? After that, increased price, profits and employment. Sorry, there is decreased competition, increased price and decreased profits and employment. So this also leads to decrease in employment because many of the importers who were relying on these Japanese cars, importing these Japanese cars and then selling them into US, they are now out of work. So this harms the country also. This harms the importing country also and benefits in the sense that that their local industry is protected. So the importing country has to maintain a balance or has to measure the pros and cons and then take action accordingly, right? Okay, in spite of these benefits to producers, VERs reduce national welfare, as I just told you, since US consumers, they are not able to access cheaper good quality cars now by creating negative trade effects, negative consumption distortions and negative production distortions. So as I just told you, there are harmful effects on the importing country as well in the terms that their industry might not be able to develop to its full potential or optimum potential, right? So I hope now these points are clear to you and we can move ahead to the next question for today. And here is your third question for today, which says a dash is like any other bank but operating on a smaller scale without involving any credit risk. So which one of the five options that you see here you think that is not going to involve any credit risk? Aapko kya lagta hai in panchon mein se kaun sa option aisa hoga jo kisi bhi alag bank ki tarah baki banks ki tarah kaam karta hai but smaller scale pe and uske sath koi credit risk associated nahi hota? Let's see who answers correctly. And the correct option for this question is E, that is payments bank. So payments bank is like any other bank but it does not involve any credit risk. So why is there no credit risk? This is because the payments bank, they cannot lend. Usually what is the function of a normal bank? It takes the deposits, collects the money and then lends and makes a profit on the difference of interest rates that it pays on borrowing and that it charges on lending, right? But this is not in the case of payments bank because payment bank are not allowed to lend. So this question was asked by Naveen Kumar. Naveen, I hope you watch this video and your doubts get clear. You asked me to differentiate between payments bank and small finance bank. So a payments bank is basically payments bank's major main objective is financial inclusion, to include to provide banking services to that sector of society, to that section of society which have been deprived by it or which has been underprivileged, right? So payments bank does the job of providing basic banking services to them, but it is not allowed to lend, just to keep the deposit safer so that it does not take any risks, right? Whereas a small finance bank, what does a small finance bank do? It obviously lends, but it lends in very smaller amounts or it lends to smaller businesses. Basically, the job of small finance bank is to provide credit to the underprivileged section of the society. So do you get the difference? Payment bank, financial inclusion in the terms, providing banking services to underprivileged section, whereas small finance banks providing credit to underprivileged section of the society, right? So the major difference is this, that payments bank, they are not allowed to lend, whereas the main job of an SFB, a small finance bank, is to lend, right? Here you can see some more information about payments bank. It accepts demand deposits, So initially it was restricted to 1 lakh per individual customer. That means it cannot accept deposits more than 1 lakh per individual customer. But usually what these payment banks do, they tie up with some other bigger banks, and if any customer deposits more money than this limit, than this 1 lakh, then they transfer their funds to their accounts in the other bank with which it has tied up, right? And some 2-3 months back, payments banks were asking RBI to increase this limit so that they can grow their operations, right? They can issue ATM cards, debit cards. They cannot issue credit cards, they can issue debit cards. Payments bank, however, cannot issue credit cards, cannot undertake lending activities. So I hope this gives you a broad overview of scope of activities of payments bank. So here you can see what they can do: offer internet banking, they can sell mutual funds, insurance. So not some risky schemes, but only some basic schemes: insurance, pensions, ATMs. What are business correspondents? Some other people hired to spread the services of bank in remote areas, right? So someone hired to spread the services or to talk to people in remote areas to provide them with an access to these banking services. Offer bill payment for customers, transfer from mobile phone, offer forex services at charges lower than banks, can provide ATM or debit cards but not credit cards, offer a card acceptance mechanism to third parties such as Apple Pay. So these are some activities that payment banks can do. What they cannot do: cannot offer credit cards, cannot extend loans, cannot handle cross-border or international remittances, cannot accept NRI deposits, right? So I hope now you must be clear between the difference between a payments bank and a small finance bank. Now moving ahead. Okay, before moving to question number 4, I would like to tell you one thing, that the financial viability of payments bank currently, the financial situation of payments bank currently in the country is not very good. It was an initiative by RBI to spread the services. As you can see here, they are providing some very basic services, and their major aim is to tap the underprivileged section. But they are not doing very well because their business model is not very viable. So if they cannot lend, it is very difficult to make money. So how can they make money? Whatever deposits they get from their customers that are limited to 1 lakh per customer, they can invest this money into government securities and make money off them. But as you all know, government securities safer in nature, that is why lower return. So basically they are not allowed to take risks, which limits their growth, which limits their profitability. That is why many of the payments banks, so this initiative came up with a lot of pomp and show, and a lot of buzz was around there, but now it has fizzled off and the situation is not very well of payment bank currently in the country, right? Okay, here is your fourth question for today, which says, in an economy where the central bank has provided borrowers with a moratorium of a few months, which of the following can inflate the income of banks? So here is a situation given to you, that there is an economy, and in that economy the central bank has provided the borrowers with moratorium of a few months, right? So there can be any situation where borrowers cannot pay, like a pandemic which affects the income of people, and in that situation central bank has provided moratorium of a few months to the borrowers. Now you have to tell which of the following can inflate the income of banks in such situation, right? So you have to tell the correct option for this question, and the correct option for this question is option B. Guys, could you just give me a second? Just give me a second. Okay. So the correct option is B. So all those of you who answered as B, you guys are absolutely right. So interest due from borrowers charged on an accrual basis can inflate the income of banks in such situations. Recently there was an article in Livemint. So all those of you who read Livemint on a regular basis, I think you must be aware about this. There was an article in Livemint about this, that since the outbreak of the pandemic, the COVID-19, it was expected that the income or the profitability of banks is going to go south, is going to go down very badly. But it didn't happen. The results were not as bad as expected. We are not saying that the results were very good, because obviously there is going to be impact of this pandemic, but results were not as bad as expected. Jitne bure results soche gaye the, utne bure banks ke result nahi aaye, right? And उसके पीछे कोई तो रीज़न होगा. उसके पीछे एक बहुत बड़ा रीज़न है. इट्स बेसिकली एन अकाउंटिंग ट्रिक. सो दोज ऑफ यू हु बिलोंग टू सॉरी कॉमर्स बैकग्राउंड, यू मस्ट बी नोइंग अबाउट द अक्रूअल कॉन्सेप्ट. सो अकॉर्डिंग टू दिस, व्हाट वी डू इन अकाउंट्स इज वी रिकॉर्ड एन इनकम वेन एवर इट इज ड्यू. इट डज नॉट मैटर दैट वेदर वी हैव रिसीव्ड इट इन कैश or whether we have received it in cash or not, but we record the income whenever it is due. So let's say you are a worker who gets, you are an employee who gets 50,000 monthly salary. Now as the month starts, you say that okay, I have got 50,000 as an income. It does not matter that whether your company has paid you or not paid you, your employer has paid you or not paid you till now, but you are saying, okay, my income is 50,000, right? Because you are working on an accrual basis, recording a transaction when it is due, not when it actually takes place, right? So that is what banks do whenever interest is due from borrowers. सो यू नो दैट बोरोअर्स हैव टू पे इंटरेस्ट टू बैंक. आपको पता है कि बैंक से लोन लिया जाता है, जो भी बोरोअर्स लोन लेते हैं उनको वो लोन पे इंटरेस्ट देना पड़ता है बैंक को. तो ये इंटरेस्ट जब ड्यू हो जाता है बैंक्स का, वो तभी उसको एज इनकम रिकॉर्ड कर लेते हैं. और इससे मैटर नहीं करता कि क्या बैंक्स ने ये इंटरेस्ट कैश में रिसीव किया है, सॉरी बैंक्स ने ये इंटरेस्ट एक्चुअली रिसीव किया है या नहीं किया है, बट दे आर रिकॉर्डिंग इट एज एन इनकम वेन एवर इट इज ड्यू रादर देन वेन दे रिसीव इट इन कैश. सो दैट इज द बेसिक अक्रूअल प्रिंसिपल ऑन विच दिस अकाउंटिंग सिस्टम वर्क्स, राइट? सो नाउ कमिंग बैक टू आवर क्वेश्चन. Now you know that moratorium has been provided to borrowers in current situation, and but the banks are charging the interest as their income. So whatever interest that has been due in this moratorium period mein jo bhi interest due hua hai, chahe wo borrowers ne pay kiya hai ya nahi kiya hai, whether or not the borrowers have paid, banks have recorded it as an income. So this is not clever trick that they are playing. This is a basic accounting rule, right? So they have recorded it as an income. That is why the defaults are not recorded. And since there is a huge hit to people's income because of pandemic, that is why it is expected that there would be many people who would not be able to pay after moratorium, and there are going to be defaults. And these defaults are not considered as of now. That is why the profitability is not that bad, right? I hope now you are clear with this. As you can see here, Indian banks are now they have been forced to increase provisions, take a hit on profits. There has been one comforting factor: core performance of most banks have been encouraging, right? The results have been encouraging. Answer lies in a simple accounting norm where net interest income is considered on an accrual basis. Whenever interest is due, it is considered as received, whether or not it is received actually or not, even though the borrower may eventually defaulting, right? हो सकता है borrower बाद में default कर दे, but हमने तो मान लिया कि income हो चुकी है क्योंकि वो due हो चुकी है payment, right? जैसे कि मैंने आपको बोला कि आपकी salary अगर month start हो चुका है, if the month has started, you are thinking, okay, my income is 50,000. It might be possible that your employer might not be able to pay to you in future, right? So moratorium of 6 months granted to borrowers has distorted this metric. Now despite the moratorium, the interest on loans has accrued to banks and hence is taken into the calculation of net interest income for the quarter. So discuss this point. That means borrower who have opted for moratorium may not actually paid the interest, but lenders considered the interest as received. Indian banks might see worst coming once the moratorium ends in August. So once the moratorium ends, borrowers, the actual default of borrowers might get recognized. That is going to be a huge blow to banks. They can see a surge or rise in bad loans, which means more pressure on their core income. So these bad loans, the possibility of these bad loans has not been accommodated as of yet. But okay, banks have been asked to increase provisions, but still the bad loans, the default, the possibility or probability of default has not been recognized yet, which might reveal itself in August once the moratorium ends, right? Okay, if the moratorium is extended, then we can say it might, the recognition might take some time, but we'll have to wait for it, that what happens. So here is your last question for today, which says the financial stability report, popularly known as FSR, is published by RBI dash for reviewing the nature, magnitude and implications of risk that may have an impact on the on the macroeconomic environment, financial institutions, markets and infrastructure. So basically, it's a report which is published by RBI. You have to tell the frequency. A very simple question, and the correct option for this question is B, semi-annually. That is twice in a year, this report is published by RBI, right? As you can see here, it is usually published in June and December. As you can see here, RBI released its 21st issue of FSR on 24 July 2020. So this FSR's 21st issue was released, and here are some major highlights of that report. So guys, these are basically stats, and I don't think there is much to talk about or much to discuss about here. You can see there is signs of stress in small businesses and retail borrowers, as many of them have availed the facility of moratorium. They have not paid their interest as of now, and we'll have to wait that how many of them turn up into defaults. Growing NPAs, so RBI is expecting NPAs, that is non-performing assets, to grow at least by 4 percentage points to 12.5, which was currently 8.5 in March 2020, right? And it can climb up to 14.7 under extreme stress. So if the situation is real bad, then it can climb up to 14.7. If the situation is not that bad, it might climb up to 12.5. Lowered interest rates, as RBI has taken many initiatives to lower the interest rates, that have shown the impact by softening the interest rates. Worrisome results of stress test regarding capital adequacy of banks. So guys, we have already learned what is stress test in our previous sessions. So the stress test, which actually judges or which actually sees how strong is the capability of bank to handle the default, right? So stress test regarding capital adequacy shows some worrisome results, and it is saying that many banks might not be able to retain the minimum capital. As you can see here, it indicates that three banks may fail to maintain their minimum capital level by March 2021. Three banks might fail if the scenario is not that bad, and five banks may fail to maintain the minimum capital if there is a severe stress scenario or if there is an extremely bad condition, right? So these are some major highlights of this financial stability report. Many of you were asking about this report, and there is, I think, more statistics involved, and I think this provides you with some sort of summarized view of the report, right? So guys, these were the five questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. Now, before ending this session, I would like to discuss an article which Harsha was asking about. Let me just open that article. I was not able to find it online. Probably you have to take the subscription of ET for it. The article was published in ET. Let me just check. Just give me a second. That article was on MIBOR, right? So the article is called "How Real Is MIBOR? Time for a Relook." So it's a very interesting article. I really liked studying about it. But Harsha, do remember one thing. Whatever is given in this article, there are not much evidences behind it, right? So many of the experts say that it is nothing but just a discussion, and it holds no credibility. right? But since you asked us to discuss, we are discussing about it. Now, I'm sorry, what does this article say? So we all know what is MIBOR, Mumbai Interbank Offered Rate, based on the model of LIBOR, that is London Interbank Offered Rate. So basically, MIBOR is a rate that different banks charge to each other in their borrowing and lending activities. So MIBOR is the rate that one bank charges to another when it lends to the bank. So that is why it is called interbank, right? Now, what this article is saying, it is saying that MIBOR is being MIBOR is being pushed to artificial high levels, and it does not reflect the actual lending rates that the banks have to face, right? And how does this work? Let us discuss it in some detail. Now, okay, MIBOR is calculated every day. So how is it calculated? It is calculated in the first hour of the day, and whatever trades take place in this first hour, MIBOR is calculated on that basis, right? Now, this article says that some institutions try to pull this rate up. कुछ institutions जो हैं वो इसको artificially high रखना चाहते हैं. क्यों रखना चाहते हैं उसको भी हम discuss करेंगे बाद में, but अभी discuss करते हैं कैसे रखना चाहते हैं. Now what happens is many of the financial institutions, some of the financial institutions, a few of them, they borrow really aggressively in the first hour or at the beginning of the day. Now if they are borrowing aggressively, there are large number of borrowers. Obviously, the interest rate is going to be pushed up because there is huge demand for money. That is why MIBOR is pushed up when few borrowers, they borrow really aggressively. So do take into account, the number of borrowers is not much, but they are borrowing higher amounts. That is why MIBOR is being pushed up. So this is the action of a few institutions, right? Now, why is this a concern? Because they say after that, when this rests, once MIBOR is calculated, what happens is cooperative banks, they come into play. As you know, cooperative banks, they usually lend to their members only, right? But they lend in the interbank market also. So their scope of lending activities is very limited. That is why these cooperative banks, when in interbank market, they lend to other private banks, they lend at very low interest rates. So few borrowers pushing up the MIBOR by borrowing aggressively at the beginning of the day. But after that, when it gets settled, when the calculations is done, cooperative banks, they come into play and they lend to private sector on low rates. Why low rates? Because first of all, these private banks, they maintain accounts of cooperative banks in which their government securities are held. So cooperative banks are required to invest in government securities, which is usually maintained directly with SGL accounts with RBI or with some private banks, right? Or with some banks. So these banks who maintain the accounts of our cooperative banks, of government securities, they have very good relations with these cooperative banks. And as you know, the scale of cooperative banks is not much. That is why these private sector banks or institutions, they are powerful. That is why they are able to borrow from these cooperative banks at low rates. So MIBOR pushed up at the beginning of day, and after that, banks borrowing at low rates. So there is a gap between the MIBOR calculated in the morning and the actual rates which is available to most of the institutions calculated at the rest on the rest part of the day, right? So basically, the calculation of MIBOR is not reflecting this fall in the rates that cooperative banks is offering to the private sector, right? So many people, many experts or many spectators are citing that some institutions want to keep MIBOR artificially high. And why do they want to do it? Because many loans that they make are linked to MIBOR. That is why they want to keep that rate high so that their interest income does not fall. Apart from that, many players, many institutions, many of these institutions, they invest in interest swap derivatives. So guys, we have already discussed the interest swap derivatives in one of our previous session in much detail. If you're not aware about it, you can ask for its link in the comments on the video. Now, what happens is, someone who thinks that MIBOR, the interbank rate, it is going to reflect this fall, enters into an agreement to exchange this floating rate, with a fixed rate, right? So, okay, I think we will have to take an example. So, there is a trader, let's say, this trader thinks that MIBOR is going to fall, right? So, since he thinks MIBOR is going to fall, what does he do? He enters into an agreement with someone who thinks MIBOR is not going to fall, right? Or MIBOR is going to stay high. Now, this trader says that, okay, I will pay interest on the basis of MIBOR to you. Do take into account that trader is thinking MIBOR is going to fall. So MIBOR is a floating rate. So we discussed that interest rate swap, they usually work exchanging a floating rate stream to a fixed rate stream, right? So trader agrees to pay MIBOR because he thinks that it is going to fall, and says, okay, you pay me on the basis of a fixed rate. Now, trader is thinking that MIBOR is going to fall below this fixed rate, and obviously he is going to have a profit because he would have to pay lesser interest as MIBOR falls and receive higher interest on this fixed rate amount, right? But when this does not happen, the MIBOR is pushed up artificially according to this article, then these type of traders, they face losses. And the other party who is having profit out of high MIBOR is usually these type of financial institutions who have interest in keeping the MIBOR rates up, right? So some experts say that this is nothing but cribbing by these traders who are making losses, and nothing like this artificial push-up exists, right? So this is the entire gist of the article, that whether we need to make some changes into MIBOR's calculation or not, so that it reflects the fall in the average call rates, in the average call money rates that banks actually face in the interbank market, right? So I hope now you are clear with this article, Harsha. And guys, this is it for today. Thank you for being here, and I hope you are benefiting from these sessions. And if you do, then don't forget to hit the like button. I'll be back tomorrow with some new set of information. Thank you for watching.